Hey there, everybody. Welcome to our session on Dynamics NAV and Power BI. My name is Andrew King, and I just wanted to share with you today kind of how easy it is to get information out of NAV into Power BI. So we're going to jump right in, and a couple things we're going to do. We're going to talk about how this really works, an oData web services connection to Power BI. For those of you that don't know, oData stands for Open Data Protocol, and Microsoft has been using this for quite a while. It allows us to connect Dynamics NAV data right into Power BI. We're going to go build a little sales dashboard and just kind of show you how easy that is once that data is connected to Power BI. And then once that report is published, we'll show you how you go into the Power BI dashboard on the web, and you can share it with your team through Office 365 and then see that dashboard, manipulate that dashboard for reporting purposes. Then we'll show you a couple different examples of dashboards and reports, one from the jobs module in NAV to show some really rich data around jobs information, deferred revenue, work in process, etc. And then we'll go and show you an example financial report with even drill down back to the transaction level as far as what took place and how you can go find that information back in NAV. So without further ado, let's jump right in, and thank you everybody for joining us today. So let's take you first into Navision and this concept of what I want to see. Let me just resume the connection because it timed out there for a couple seconds. But what I want to see is really sales invoices. So I want to see revenue. I want to see the products that I sold. I want to see the revenue associated with it. I want to look at the customers that I've sold it to or sold things to. Maybe I want to look at gross margin analysis. So that's all going to come from the posted sales invoice section of Dynamics NAV. And if we drill into just one of these invoices here, what you can see is there's header level information, i.e., you know, when this invoice was posted, and then there's line level information, so what was sold. And what we're going to do is we really want to see this information in dashboards, and it's going to contain information from both the header, because I want to look at the customer, I want to look at dates, and it's going to contain information from the line item, which is the item that sold and the gross margin analysis from there. Okay. Now, the way this works is I'm just going to switch tabs here and show you the web services connections. What I've done is simply enabled the header level invoice sales and the line item sales through oData. And what the system automatically generates for us is this link to basically paste into Power BI and use any way we want. And all of these items on this list can be seen or used in Power BI for reporting. So once that view is enabled, it's very easily accessed from Power BI. So we're going to jump into Power BI now, and you can see here, if I go to my recent sources, this is that oData connection from our demo system. Okay. So what I want to do is I want to create a sales dashboard. So first thing off the top of my head is, you know what, I want to create a sales dashboard that really just shows me revenue by month. Let's start pretty straightforward. And you can see over here to the right side, I've got these two tables that I'm going to choose from, as I discussed earlier, that header versus line. And if you look over here in Power BI, you can see the system formed a relationship between these two tables automatically, and it's based on the document number. So at the line level and at the header level, I've got that document number that's going to tie those two tables together. Now, from an end user perspective, quite frankly, I can care less, and I don't even need to know that. The system took care of that table relationship for me. So basically what I have here is just I just have a bunch of fields that I can choose to use right out of the oData connection in my reporting. Okay, and these different visualizations are all the different types of graphs and charts and tables and things like that that I can make using the data that I've now connected to Dynamics NAV. So first thing we're going to start with is a simple line chart. Okay, and I'm going to go get the revenue from my line level detail, and that's going to be sales amount, and that's going to be basically the values of the data that are brought in. Okay, and then the other thing I want to do is I want to show revenue over time. So from the header level of the invoices, we're going to pull the actual document date. And quite simply, what you end up with is a nice little chart here just showing revenue by date. So in August, we did $309,000. In July, we did $6,000. And I got a nice little chart that quickly that quickly displays that. Now, if I just click on that chart, I can clean it up a little bit. So as an example, maybe I want to see the data labels. And you know what? Maybe I want to actually see in this chart really quickly the actual detail numbers with maybe no decimal points, because I don't care about decimal points. So we'll display to full precision, and we'll say no decimal points. Okay? And so now I've got a little graph that shows me my revenue by month. Okay? So that's pretty straightforward. Now let's do the same thing again. This time, I want to do this same kind of idea, but I'm going to use a stacked bar chart because now I want to superimpose customer on top of this. So again, we're going to go back to the document date, and we're going to put that on our x-axis. Okay, so we're going to drag that little guy right over here. Then we're going to go down to our line level detail, and we're going to drag the, again, sales amount right over here into our value. Okay, and then finally, what we want to do is we want to capture the customer. So this sell to customer, we're going to put down here as the legend. Okay, we'll pull that little guy up over here and give it a bit of a stretch. So now what I've got is I've basically got the exact same information over here, okay? But now I've got it broken out by customer. So I can see that we sold $300,000 of the $309 to John Haddock Insurance in the month of August, okay? So now given part of the ability for you as an end user to create these graphs and charts is you obviously have to know a little bit about the data model. And that goes kind of without saying. So at the end of the day, if you're familiar with what you're looking for, it's very, very simple to create these graphs and charts. They're literally just drag and drop. Now, as I mentioned to you earlier, I want to get into a little bit about item profitability. So we're going to now put what's called a little matrix table in here. And I'm just kind of trying to give you a flavor for how this really works. And what I want to do is I want to show, say, the item number. Okay, so we're going to drag that little guy, which is right here, over to this table. And then what I want to show is the unit cost, okay? So we're going to drag that little guy over here. I want to show the price, so we're going to drag that little guy over here. Now, again, I could drag it right here into values, or I can drag it over here into the actual chart, okay? Now, the last thing I did is I created, the system allows you, if we go to modeling, you can create measurements, which are basically just formulas. So what I did was I created this little formula. You can see it here. Gross margin per unit is just the average of the unit price that was sold and the average of the unit cost. So I want to drag that little guy over here because I want to see that. And then I also did the exact same thing with what's called gross margin percent. So I've got the invoice line gross margin per unit divided by the unit cost to give me a percentage. I'm going to drag that little guy over here too. Now, a couple things. The unit cost over here, I need to make that an average. So what I'm going to do is I want to just change that from a summary to an average, and I want to also look at the average of the unit price. And then suddenly what I have is a nice little table that gives me basically by my items what the average cost was, what the average sale price was, and then my average gross margin per unit and my average gross margin percent. So pretty straightforward. Now for the ones that are dividing by zero, this is a test system, so forgive the fact that some of my items have zero cost. Some of these things are just infinity calculations, okay? And we'll see in my next little chart kind of how that plays out, because I'm going to have to use that as a bit of a filter. But now I've got my little revenue chart here. I've got that same information now broken out by customer. And I've got also a little table that just gives me information on average gross margin sales price. But let's say I want to make that just a little bit fancier. So this time I'm going to use what's called a bubble chart, okay? And what I'm going to do is we're actually going to put the sales amount down on the x-axis, okay? So we're going to drag that little guy over here. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to put the gross margin per unit actually up on the y-axis, okay? Because I want to now see my gross margin across those items. I'm going to actually use the item number now as the legend so I can see the different items across the top. And I want gross margin percent to actually represent the size of the bubble, okay? Now, you notice these bubble sizes just changed a little bit. But one other thing here is that for my gross margin percent, you notice I've got these little infinities here. Well, that's going to skew my bubble sizes because infinity is going to be a really, really big bubble, and these little guys are going to be small bubbles. So I want to eliminate kind of those infinity ones. So what I'm going to do is we're just going to apply a filter, and I'm just going to say where that gross margin dollar, or sorry, gross margin percent is literally not equal to infinity, and apply that filter. And when we grow this, you'll see now I've got a chart that's actually legible. Okay? And that's literally all it takes to build some charts and graphs and tables. And depending on what I want to do, I can change these visualizations to, quite frankly, anything I want. But this is just all coming from the posted invoice and sales header and sales line. And I think from a timing perspective, that may have taken me, 5-7 minutes to build all this stuff. And that's pretty much it. So the last step is I would save this, okay, and I called it sales line header visualizations. And last but not least, I would publish this then to Power BI, okay, which I can go do right here. So I hit publish. I'm going to put it in my workspace. And again, this can be shared with anybody in my organization, so it's just publishing that right now. It asked me if I wanted to override this because obviously I've tried this a few times, okay? And now for everybody in my organization, when I go to Power BI here and refresh my screen, you'll see there's now a page 5, and quite frankly, that's exactly what we just created. So even to get that up in Power BI for all of our users that are on Office 365, it's a very straightforward operation. Now, the beauty of this is I've got this little table here, and let's just say as an example, I want to see all of this data related to this S70078 item. When I click on it, it automatically applies a global filter to all of my charts. So now I'm looking at all of my revenue by month. I see in July I sold $6,049.91. There it is in July, kind of broken down by the particular customer, which you can see is Candoxy. I've got my gross margin analysis over here, and everything's been pre-filtered by this item code. So that's automatic feature, comes with Power BI, and just allows you to slice and dice information, quite frankly, any way you want. Okay, now let's go back and take a look at that invoice, because the data that we're looking at in that example, there's that $6,049 that we just talked about. It was indeed sold in July. It is that S70078 item number, and it was sold to Candoxy. So in my dashboard, this is that actual invoice detail that I'm looking at. Okay, now this item was just sold once, so that's why there's only one little bubble here and kind of one data point. But at the end of the day, this applies to any of these items that I want to highlight. Okay, so that's kind of one flavor of a report, and that's how you build it from scratch. So once that data connection is published, you can use any of that data to slice and dice the information any way you want. Now, you can do a lot of formatting to make these charts and graphs prettier. You can put outlines on them. You can boldface. You can italicize, etc. So if I go back to my workspace and take a look at reports, and we look at this same idea across a jobs dashboard, you'll see something a little cleaner, a little more colorful. So when it comes to project accounting, really what you want to see in project accounting is the profitability of projects. You want to see what's left on a project. You might want to see work in process or revenue that you've earned or even deferred revenue. Well, you'll notice in my test system, I've only got 4 or 5 projects here. And what I'm doing is for each of these, I can show very readily what my earned revenue is, what costs have been incurred and recognized, what my profit is for this particular project, and what my deferred revenue is that's still sitting there on my balance sheet that's outstanding. I can also use that same information to look at the percent invoiced or the percent complete for a particular project. And keep in mind, any of these visualizations, I just chose pie charts and graphs and things like that just to make it look cool. But if you want tables, you can do tables. If you want cool charts, you can do charts, etc. This is just a breakdown of these deal details into a little more level. I've now got profitability as a graph. I can also superimpose that by customer. So again, just sliced a different way. I can look at what's remaining to bill versus what's remaining in costs. Okay. I can look at my total deferred revenue as a pie chart, even though I've got it up here. And I can look at what's been invoiced to date across these jobs. Now, just like the other visualization that I showed, I can just click on this little job and it filters everything accordingly. So I can quickly look at my profitability of this job. I can look at the cost that I've incurred. I can look at my deferred revenue chart, and I can look at what's yet to bill. So I see I've got $150,000 yet to bill, and I've got $75,000 of costs left to incur, and I've already invoiced $300,000. And keep in mind, $37,000 of this customer's profitability is related to this particular job that you can still see right up here. Okay, so again, it allows me to slice and dice. If we actually go back into Navision here and take a look at that job, you can see all this same information right down here. Percent complete at 9.9%, percent invoice 64. Here's all those numbers, and there's that profitability of 37,000 that we were just looking at, and that was recognized cost. So this is the detail from this job, just put in a much more colorful, quite frankly, cleaner way. Okay, so again, some pretty cool stuff you can do with Power BI to slice and dice information. And also keep in mind, this same graph and chart, once it's published for all my users to see, is also available on mobile phone. And on a mobile phone, I can slice and dice this information just by clicking on it with my finger. Okay, now, this is summary level information. Let's take a look at what we can do when we want to do some drill down. So what we also did as a simple example is we created this basic chart of accounts. And a couple things we did here is one, we gave it a posting date filter. So if I want to just look at August of 2017, I can just take a look at, quite frankly, that month. Okay, I can extend that out to take a look at more postings. I can take a look at July. So I can slide this out. I can also, we made it a slider because it kind of looks cool. But if I wanted to make this a particular month and you just click on the months as a filter, I can do that as well. Okay, now at the end of the day, if I take a look at this whole date range, if you will, I can click into, say, cost of goods sold, and we can take a look at job cost as an example. Sorry, I have to turn drill down on, so that's that little checkbox there. When I drill in, now I can see in that 20,000 what are these individual lines, and if I actually go into one particular one, I can see all of the invoices that led me to charge this particular GL account for purchases and raw materials. Now, we've stopped the drill down there. We're not really drilling back to these original invoices. But again, you can go right into NAV and just look at these invoice numbers that are posted and go find the particular items that led to these particular GL account entries. And I can go back up all the way. I can keep going, okay, all the way to the top. And again, if I want to take a look, say, one level down, I can quickly do that in any of these particular areas and get to that level of detail. So same situation, I can go drill into income. I can go drill into income here. I can drill into income here and see there were two journal entries that led to that particular revenue at that particular level of the account. So that's a pretty high level view of this stuff. Now from a timing perspective, the question is, okay, this looks all great and pretty, but how long did this really take to do? Well, you saw in the sales one, I mean, maybe that took me 7 minutes from start to finish, not terribly difficult. When you look at the details in this one's actually just simply made up of these individual journal lines from the system and simply turned into a pivot chart to create an income and expense. Now, we could have spent time making this pretty and different colors for different indents and all that fun stuff, but that's really cosmetic. So from start to finish to build this, I mean, you might be talking about, say, 15 minutes or so. And again, just slicing and dicing and grouping these different summaries. Because keep in mind, this chart of accounts is built on the detailed transactions that make it up. So the drill down's already there because it's, quite frankly, made up of the transactions that are there anyway. When we take a look at the jobs one, that took a little bit more time, but quite frankly, this is made up of three tables from NAV that all were related based on job number. Now, from an end user perspective, I'm dragging and dropping information from all these different tables, but it took me longer to create these nice boxes and maybe retitle them than it did to actually create the charts and graph themselves. So this whole thing maybe took 30 minutes, maybe 45 or so. But again, about half that time was just spent making it look pretty, to be frank with you. So all in, these three dashboards maybe took about an hour and a half total from start to finish. But once those data connections are made from NAV, which like I said is simply just publishing those web services, you generate these reports on your desktop version of Power BI and simply publish them then to the group that wants to see them. So very straightforward. So hopefully that gives you a good sense of how Power BI works, how these reports are generated, and really the information you can get out of the system that anybody now can get over a web page without too much difficulty. Okay? So thanks for joining us today, and hopefully that gives you a good outline of what Power BI and NAV can do. Have an awesome day, and we'll chat later.